established last year a steering group, and that's met. It's now just second year. All key partners and other key stakeholders are around the table. The group is now chaired by Councillor Brightmore, who moved on from Councillor Scrutiny. We are awaiting a new place champion, having seen the board move on from his previous role. Okay, the way we measure our the two headline measurements for our performance in terms of the pledge are two things simply, and there's a number of underlying measures that support them. The two measures that are key to us are measures of local environmental quality, how clean our highway and streets are, and our HR performance. And as you know, I've been in this room in front of over the Scrutiny Committee before, we have a committed pledge to 50% recycling by 2020. The headline is that in 2017 we've overachieved the contractual target we have with BIFA for local environment quality. And in terms of recycling, as is the position regionally and nationally, our performance is flatlining, and indeed that's the reason why we've been presented to you a fundamental change to service to make that target. The details below that, the headlines there, I'll cover as part of the presentation. So what I'm going to do is we have in the two strategies there are four key priorities per strategy. I'll basically cover them quickly, as I said earlier, what we've done in 16-17 and what we're moving to in this year. In fact, what I want to do is measure what we're moving to this year at the moment. So I think the key thing in the Loving Our Dog strategy is that it's priority one, the relationship that we have with residents and the relationship they have with their environment. It's all about getting people involved in their neighbourhood, taking pride in it, wanting to do more, taking more responsibility for their actions. And we established last year the Love Where You Live campaign, which is getting people to volunteer and get involved in their neighbourhood. We recognised that last year was just a starting point, and we want to push this much further. We want to floor the pedal on this particular issue. We want to put in place proper resources in terms of what volunteer groups want to use, and other things like disposal, and also produce quality promotion materials that we can use. And we want your help, we want members' help to engage with groups and individuals that want to get involved. Well, particularly where there's a lack of representation. But we know there are good groups, we know there's good practice out there, new partners I mentioned there, but that's all very well. We want to get into the areas where there isn't good publicity. By the way, the money that we're using to fund these kits, this resource and publicity, is directly from our prosecutions on littering and dog farm. That's where it's coming from. So a major focus of my time, my officer's time, is making sure Love Where You Live, getting people involved, is our focus point. And using the well-known brand that you know of, Love Wirral, to promote that. And there's great work going on, but there's more to be done. A good case study of Love Where You Live is this example in Woodchurch, where local members, local stakeholders got together with high-volume people everywhere, and basically addressed a cross spot in the middle of Woodchurch estate. They transformed themselves with the individuals that without help, and they're now carrying on sustainable improvement today. A really good piece of work. It's right in the heart of that estate. We want to see more of that. There's good examples, as I say, with Brightness, West Kirby Beach recently, and the hot weather meant the beach was bombed. Volunteers got involved and helped the council and our partners turn that around. The second one is crucial, it's key, it links to people getting involved in their local area and taking more responsibility for their actions. What we've done, I think, we haven't had a good reputation as a council following through on action for people that seem to be tough on environmental crime and those who committed. I think in the last couple of years, we've shown to council we will take action. You see the numbers there in terms of littering and dog fouling. Now you're dumping. That doesn't include the action against fly tippers, so which resulted last year in two custodial sentences about perennial fly tippers. We want to drive a change. We think there's a formative part that we've started on over the last couple of years. If we have a long-term approach to this, we will see behaviour change. The elements that we are building into place are a 2 years, around the annual target, as you see for littering, was exceeded by 11,000 text-expressed notices. Dog fouling, first year last year, since May, the 9th of May, 227 text-expressed notices. Best in practice and intervention since 2004 was Barnsley, with 350 FPNs on a long-term arrangement. So you can see we have a good year, which we can improve on. We'll talk, I'm sure you'll ask about how we use intelligence, can we use intelligence more? We get more feedback from residents. Yes, 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 we want all that to help us drive the service on improvements. Something else that the Kingman took on from if we're good at collecting waste, perhaps not some enforcement, is that we have a two-man team that are in any ways looking for evidence, taking action, back on doors when we find evidence and issue fixed notice on putting resources where needed. We've got finite resources, 13-14, you probably remember, took £1 million out of £5 million budget. It's almost a quarter of our resource. It means we need to be clever with how we use it. We shouldn't clean, we can't clean when we don't need to clean. We need to put the resource where it needs to be. And we don't want to keep doing the backsides. We want to take action against it. It's not shoving resources into one place. It's being clever with the resource that we've got and using intelligence. And you can see there that we were shortlisted by the Association for Public Sector Excellence as most improved council on street cleansing. We've been surprised, one of the first awards we were nominated, we didn't even know we'd been nominated. The reason that their criteria for that was the level of resource we've got left and the performance, the outcome, the local environment quality mentioned earlier in that year. We were nominated for that award. We're going to carry that on in this year and continue to look at resource, particularly the way we've cleansed our waste and where we don't need to, where we need to put more service. Another one, I've been around the Consistency Committee for Recent Economic Policy tomorrow. Keen to get your views on broad spots. Last year was the first year for this initiative. You can see the numbers there, some very positive outcomes there. Again, the money we put forward, which is about £40,000 budget, was directly from prosecution income credit. That budget, we didn't have that resource before. We go on, we can do work in default. As you can see there, again, you've seen this recently in the committees, that we've identified 26 sites and served notice on them. Of those 26 sites, 18 of them have received formal notice, did the work themselves. And in fact, a further update for you there, of those 18 sites, 5 of them are being developed now, so a real positive outcome. Messy sites, untidy cross park, causing detriment to the community or problems for the community, tidy up in a sustainable way and now being developed. And all the work that we've been doing as well. And we recognise that there's more there. We're asking for more sites. We're keen to crack on with Crosspot Action Plan 2 this year and carry on doing that. And you've seen this again in the committees, the case study from Thurston, the highway on the approach to Hazel, where I think this was about the Crosspot Action Plan Site 1, which happened in December 16. So 40 tonnes of material removed. The key thing there was then easy access, vulnerable sites, clear the site, make sure access is denied, and we're looking for a sustainable solution with the local farmer. So, perhaps the site not in Burton Ever One Sequel, and the outskirts of Heswell has been dealt with. We're looking for more of those sort of sites. So, I'll now on to the second strategy. So, we're on the second presentation. Getting through this sort of stuff. In terms of the managing our waste, first thing in terms of waste prevention and reuse, big emphasis on this in terms of the future generation. A lot of work with schools. We're one of the few authorities that retained our eco schools officer. Most of those officers, those positions went, by the way, constantly happened. We've been very continued in that. We have more eco schools than anywhere else in the UK. It's a real base, a real conduit to get into schools, to get into local children, and really embed into them how important the environment is, things like recycling, etc. You can see some of the issues we do work with there. There's more work to be done with our partners this year, and the council partner was really keen that partners such as ourselves do more and are more involved in the partnership in terms of waste prevention and reuse. This is a case study on market and create what they call the hedge fund. It's funding the hedge for, I think it's a local school somewhere. Really, a really clever idea, really got kids involved and galvanised. We want to really push that. Council members, you know, really keen on that. Council Brightmore wants to keep pushing that and start that with that good base. All the authorities can't rely on that. We can. We've got the links into schools that we want to continue to nurture. Okay, second point, which I, you know, we've been to this committee, we had a major public consultation exercise last year. We took a major piece of work that took a year to conclude, produce the full business case, etc. Made recommendations. You'll hear from agenda item 5 that we've been, haven't been able to present that to Cabinet yet because of a regional review of the city region's waste management function. We're hoping that's going to be released soon. Mark's going to give you an update on where that is. But we have made recommendations, and the recommendations that we need to transform our recycling performance. The last remaining major elements of the green bin, residual bin, is food waste, and we're recommending food collections. And to make this work, to make it hit our performance target, you have to restrict residual capacity in some way. You have to restrict the green bin, in our case, in some way. We've read their recommendations for that. I think they are in line with the recommendations of the regional committee. But we can't present that until we've heard that. And I'm hoping Mark is going to be fairly soon. Mark will explain that to you in the next position. But we recognise that, as I said to you before, as a headline, our recycling performance is flatline. We can't just sit around for 2 years, or whatever it will take for major service change to happen. We're going to implement an interim plan based on a range of things that turns around our recycling performance. It won't hit 50% performance, but it will make us turn in the right direction. I'll come back to that in a minute. So, curbside collection schemes. We ran a Good to Go campaign last year, a promotion target. We reflect on this. If we're honest, drive by clipper boards on recycling vehicles are having no impact on recycling. We need to invest in far more targeted communication promotion this year. So we'll do much more targets through our phones or the technology in the future. The days of refuse collection vehicles messages are over. They're probably much more targeted from that. So, as I mentioned, the interim plan is a range of initiatives. It is making our assets sweat more. We've got 2 million authorised green bins out there, not much grey bins. We need to update our domestic refuse collection policy, particularly land capacity. We need to do a targeted promotion campaign, as I mentioned. We want to get our partners to do more. And finally, last but not least, as a council, our performance isn't good enough. We need to be leading by example. But internally, it's something that we need to focus on. If we're serious about recycling, the council performance needs to be taken to task. It needs to be taken there. I mentioned food is part of the in future service vision of how we're going to move forward, and it made recommendations about food, etc. In terms of garden waste subscriptions, last year we managed to recruit over 40,000 subscribers. That's the highest number since the subscription service started in 2013. This year, I mentioned earlier, we're course-weighted this year. We are around 1,400 ahead of last year's profile, so we're ahead again in terms of people retaining that service. We really want it and recognise it. And we want to keep moving that forward. I think that's it, Chair, so I hope that wasn't too much detail. Thank you very much.
Brian.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Thanks, Mike, for the presentation. Dog foul, it's always top of the list of complaints I certainly get as a local councillor from residents who say, what can we do about it? Very often they'll see somebody that they might know, you don't know where they live, how they got to power and walk off, and they get frustrated. Even as a local councillor, if I see that, I think, well, we're not allowed to go to them and say, excuse me, you know, we're going to find you or whatever. So the basic question is, what can we do? But recently I went to Australia for 2 weeks. While I was there, I didn't see any evidence at all anywhere of any dog fouling. And it was very noticeable. And when I asked people over there why that was, the answer basically was, well, society over there just wouldn't allow it. Nobody would ever dream of allowing their dog to foul and just walk away. But when you come back here, and it's a totally different culture. This afternoon I was at a residence meeting on the beach where people were raising their head, saying it's disgusting. You know, we're entering bare-headed bloom, we're trying to improve the place, putting the, you know, hanging baskets up, etc. At the same time, people are saying, but look at all the dog days, what can we do about it? So, my basic question is, what can ordinary residents do? What can we do as local councillors? Because obviously, you mentioned the fixed penalty notices, but that depends on somebody in the authority being in the right place at the right time and seeing it. But basically, what more can we all do as residents and councillors?
Okay. Well, it's topical because there was a very major news release today about highlighting how many fixed penalty notices have been done. I think the first thing is, we're a year into an enforcement regime that's been proved to work. But it can work better. I think the intelligence between yourselves as members and other committee members can be better. And I want to work on how we can extract the information that we can prioritise where the opportunities go, etc. So that's something we need to work on. One of the things I didn't mention in the presentation the committee is doing this year is we want to, for the council website, we want to have a dynamic league table or a rich picture of the borough about where enforcement action has been taken. In fact, not just for what enforcement action has been taken, but where our opportunities have been. So basically, we want to pinpoint where literally offences have been committed and found, where dog found, and where opportunities have been. So we want to work on that. But in terms of your direction, I suppose, what we need to do is we need to organise, we've talked about the way you live, getting volunteers, but I'm not talking about volunteers picking up anything from anybody else. But we need to have this culture of peer pressure. It's not nothing. The vast majority of people on work on Wirral do, I think, and that's crucial. In fact, it's almost in an amusing way. In week one of the Kingdom's enforcement regime, they set their hotshot home from Wrexham to sort of show me, we can get a bit of satisfaction at the end, we can show this thing. And she saw something like 60 good actions to one action. So she went and looked back at the empty handy for her. She managed to get the evidence. But seriously, the observation is that the vast majority of people on the world are doing the right thing. And in terms of behaviour change, we want to be promoting the good behaviour, but also that there is a consequence of actions. You're right, it's very difficult to be sometimes in the right place at the right time. I think in our team we've shown that we're on the right track, but it is going to require local action with local people coming together.
Okay, thank you. If I can just add to that, Chair, just very briefly, I don't want to just repeat what Mike says. I want to try and apply to this, but when Mike said that we need to increase intelligence, that's what's in the key. Because we have enforcement officers, it's not perfect, they are getting better, but it's about placing them where most of these offences take place. I've said before to people that if they do think there's a hotspot somewhere and they're not getting, they don't think it's getting the right attention, email me, email us if you don't think you're getting a sufficient response. We'll try and take that forward. With regards to parks and what have you, things are getting better from what I've seen, but there's still quite a lot of work to do. And it's just important that as we take forward that work, especially around enforcement, I think it's important we're pushing a positive message about how clean and beautiful is. In addition to that, when fines come in, that money's been turned around and put to use to make those areas that have been fouled back to being beautiful.
Thank you for that. Can I just ask one question? What options are being rolled out for reducing the litter among younger people?
Yes, I did
ask
you, it's another presentation, but I didn't have to refer to it. Thanks, Chair. One of the feasibility studies we're going to engage this year. Is there is obviously a hole in our litter enforcement provision because it's young people, so crucially between 10 and 18 years old. Now, you know, there's mixed feelings about how you tackle that. I mentioned this overview previously. We know some PR authorities actually do enforce against young people. You know, they may not be fined with fixed penalty notice, but they need to go there. Tackle these demands some form of restorative justice in terms of litter picking themselves or other forms of that topic. So this year, Chair, to the Cabinet, we're going to make recommendations and a visibility study
doing that, because I always think that people, if you're trying to persuade people to recycle, and they look at something that needs to be recycled, which they know is going in landfill, they're not really going to have that much confidence in our recycling plans.
In terms of the first issue, I'm not directly involved in the recent operation, but I can assure you there's very careful bins goes into it as well. That's materials, etc. And it's use that and where we can get response back on a particular issue. And obviously there is an issue about weeds that keep on top of them. It's an important issue to the council, to use all councillors. In terms of that, I totally agree. It is the best frustration for our residents to know that there's no authority literally named to the Hedgehog Board where they're allowed to put hard plastics into their recycling bin, and we can't. Yeah, so we are governed, we are a collection authority only, with the disposal authority. At the moment, the disposal authority we're talking about proper, reasonable kids, maybe not all those, but you know, good PPE, good discipline and stuff, and the perennial problem of disposal rooms. They're the things that we're going to put forward now. Perhaps previously in the past it's been, you know, ring and prayer and a favour, and this is proper resource provision that we're looking to provide for you. And in terms of if there's a third or fourth issue raised, is yes, we have a call strategy, a climate change strategy for Wirral. It's under my remit, and that's a recent development. It was too late for the Wirral plan, so that's working sort of in parallel. And the idea is that Cabinet will see an annual review in the early autumn, and you will see that report soon after. And that will be a fun. It's 3 years into the strategy, so for year three or five, it's quite a crucial juncture. We've got to that.
Firstly, thank the incoming member for the dog who might have been by
Down to actually, you know, helping to do that. We've not got one on this time, but I think members will remember that there's often that fairly thick policy informed document which is meant to help exactly that process. So really the idea would very much be that that document comes out to members, it helps them to horizon scan full views on those emerging policy areas, and obviously it's within the committee's remit that if there are areas of interest, they can be fed into the work plan for the year, and as officers we can be asked to go away and do further work around emerging policy areas such as that.
Cheers, Chair. Just to thank Warren for his kind words, point out that that's fine. And you also touched on where tourism and footfall is increasing, there should be more infrastructure. Totally agree with you. You'll know we've got, I don't want to go into a different topic, but you know we've got a fairly exciting strategy around tourism. I'm really keen on where we can predict where more people are going to be. We make sure there's increased infrastructure, if only temporarily, to make up for that. And you may have seen that.